The second type of underground stem or modification of stem possible is rhizome. So rhizome is found in ginger, rhizome is found in turmeric, rhizome is found in banana. So it's a fleshy underground horizontal. Remember, in ginger it grows horizontal, but in the case of turmeric it grows vertical. So rhizomes can be horizontal rhizomes or they can be even vertical rhizomes. So a horizontally growing or vertically growing perinating stem which produce new leaves or shoot every favorable year. So every year when conditions are good, it means spring is coming, new shoots will develop from here or new branches will develop from here. And when autumn will come, these branches will die. So this portion will survive underground. So it helps in perination. It is differentiated into nodes and internodes. You can easily see I have put lines here. These lines represent nodes and the gap between is internode. And you can call these as the branches coming up. So roots are also there. Nodes and internode with axillary buds, scale leaves and adventitious roots. For example, ginger, for example, turmeric as well as banana. The next type of underground stem is corm. Corm grows vertically, just remember this. Rhizome can be horizontal or vertical. Corm will always grow vertical. And it is fleshy, underground, unbranched, remember it is branched, unbranched, spherical or subspherical thick stem differentiated into circular nodes. So you can see here circular nodes are present, roots are also growing, and then you can see buds. I have drawn many buds. So from here new leafy shoots will develop into circular nodes with axillary buds and scales. Adventitious roots are born at the base of the corm. It helps in perination and bear leaves and shoots in every favorable condition. So easiest example is saffron. Saffron or otherwise elephant foot. You know arbi also. Arbi is an example of corm. Colocasia, alocasia, crocus are the examples of scientific names I have spoken. Are the examples of corm. In the same manner, another type of underground stem possible is tuber. Now tuber develops from, like in the case of potato, you will find a branch will grow from down, and this portion is underground. So this tip will swell and grow into a tuber. So tuber would be fleshy, swollen, round. It can be again oblong, that means not exactly always spherical, but round shape or something like a round shape. And it will have two ends. This end is closer, this end is the farther one. So you can easily make out which end is closer. When you see a potato, you can easily see there are many internodes present like this, close. These are closer ones. So this is the farthest portion and this is the portion which is attached to the stem. Then they develop from a branch, that this branch is called as the stolon. So such branches are called stolon and their tip enlarges into tuber. This stolon's branch, stolon is the branch which tip will grow into tuber, and tuber will accumulate food inside. We all know potato is a rich source of starch, and stem tubers are covered with a skin. There is a skin here, we all know that brown color in the case of potato. And remember, there will be depressions present here and there. All those depressions represent the nodes, are also called as the eyes. And in those eyes, white colored things are visible when potato germinates. Those are the branches developing. It has a scaly leaf and 1 to 3 dormant buds, and they lack adventitious roots. Remember, here roots develop, adventitious roots are there. But in the case of tuber, adventitious roots are absent. Example, Solanum tuberosum, also called as potato. The next type of underground stem is the bulb. Now bulb are of various types also, so let's understand. Bulb is also an underground perinating spherical structure with reduced discoid stem. So when you open an onion, we always find there is a disc-like structure present like this at the base, which has roots below, and then large number of scaly leaves are arranged like this. So this is the discoidal stem. So it has a reduced discoidal stem, and then there are several scaly as well as fleshy leaves. So inner leaves are fleshy, they carry the juice or the that particular smell onion has, and outer skin or outer leaves will be scaly. So outer one are scaly and they are for protection. Inner one are fleshy and they are full of food as well as water. And inside there will be the terminal bud, the point from where a flowering axis will develop. If you have seen the flower of onion, you can say inflorescence of onion, because onion does not give one flower, a bundle of flowers. Then the base bears adventitious roots below, and the terminal bud form the leafless floral axis, which is called escape. So when an onion comes to flower, you will find a large number of flowers will be there, and a hollow stem-like structure will grow from the onion, and this is called as scape. We'll be learning about this in inflorescence topic. So bulbs are of various types. The first type is called as a simple tunicated bulb. Now we all know about onion. Onion is an example of, scientific name Allium sepa, is an example of simple tunicated bulb. And the garlic is an example of compound tunicated bulb, Allium sativum. So learn the scientific names. And when we talk about lilies and all lilies are scaly imbricate type of bulb. So three types of bulbs are there, or you can say two types are there. First is tunicate, second is scaly imbricate, and tunicate again of two types, simple and compound. Now when we open an onion, you can easily see there is a single structure in the center covered with so many leaves. So that's why it is called as simple tunicated. But when we open a garlic, we would have seen a garlic will have large number of cloves in there. So first of all, garlic will have an axis same like the onion, and then this will be covered with scaly leaves. And when you open these leaves, you'll find there are small bulblets which are also again covered with the scaly leaves. That's why these are called as compound, because there are two layers of protection. First layer of protection is these small cloves covered with their own scales. And then when all these cloves are arranged around this axis, there will be scales covering the whole garlic also. That's why it is called as compound tunicate. When we talk about scaly imbricate type, remember in the scaly imbricate, fleshy scales represent the axillary buds. And remember, in this case...